Hi, this is Dr. Bertalan Meshko, the medical futurist, and in this episode, I would like to talk about the only expression anyone dealing with digital health must know to understand the context around the changes in healthcare: patient design. First, let me tell you about the powerful community that has formed out of diabetes patients. For people with diabetes, managing their condition means regularly monitoring their own blood sugar levels and then adjusting their insulin level using frequent injections of it. Here is Kerry Sparling, author of 6untilme.com and the superstar of the global diabetes community, describing what diabetes patients are thinking about.
Hi, I'm Kerry Sparling, and I've been living with type 1 diabetes for 33 years. I'm not sure if I know exactly what's trendy in terms of diabetes management, but I do know what's useful, at least to me. I've been living with type 1 diabetes since 1986, and for the last 33 years, monitoring my blood sugars has been the utmost importance to me. When I was first diagnosed, I was given a urinalysis kit to check my blood sugar using urine samples, and then I moved on to pricking my finger and using a glucose monitor in that way. But over the last decade or so, I've had access to a continuous glucose monitor, which reads my blood sugar real time. So instead of pricking my finger and getting a number, a data point, every few hours, I'm able to get results from checking in every 3 or 4 minutes, giving me streaming video of what my blood sugars are doing. And this has been instrumental in terms of transforming my care as a person with type 1 diabetes, because I'm able to see my blood sugars in context, and I'm able to make medication decisions and life decisions based on numbers that I'm seeing the ebb and flow of. And that context is so important because it allows me to live my life with diabetes as part of it, instead of living my life with diabetes at the center of it. Patients are being given access to and control of their personal health data, and this is crucial because there is no one more invested in making sure that I live well with type 1 diabetes than me.
It's a daily struggle, whether stakes are life and death. And for decades, they have been told that the cure is just 5 years away, but it never came. An FDA-approved relief came in the form of the insulin pump that can deliver the hormone directly into the wearer's body. That helps keep blood sugar more tightly within the desired range, but it can also mean pump users have to test their blood sugar more frequently than before. The solution to that problem comes in the form of a continuous glucose monitor, or CGM. This device reads the patient's blood sugar levels every 5 minutes, giving them almost real-time view of how their glucose levels are changing to help them refine their pump. But that raises a whole new problem. It gives too much information to the patient. Information that not many can actually use, but can make it even more overwhelming and stressful to manage their condition. The diabetes community needed a closed-loop system where the glucose monitor and the insulin pump are able to communicate with each other to keep the patient's blood glucose more tightly within the desired range. Essentially, they needed to replace the job of the malfunctioning pancreas with an advanced technology. Years ago, it was clear that medical technology companies could come out with the first artificial pancreas, but regulation was lagging behind. So, out of frustration over the crippling speed of bureaucracy, a movement has emerged. A movement of empowered patients who have had enough. Hence their slogan, hashtag WeAreNotWaiting. Basically, they started to create an artificial pancreas for themselves using instructions in social media and algorithms in open access databases. These devices are homemade, do-it-yourself tools designed to release insulin in response to changing blood glucose levels in a similar way to how a human pancreas does it. It's a combination of the insulin pump and the glucose monitor working together with open source software created and tailored by the community. The failure of medical hardware companies and regulatory bodies have turned the diabetic community into one of the most proactive, self-reliable, empowered patients in medicine. They are developing platforms, apps, and cloud-based solutions and reverse engineering existing products to help people with a similar condition. Of course, it's not an ideal approach, and it's outside the traditional regulated world of medicine. But still, the diabetes community managed to start a health revolution. And in 2016, the first FDA-approved artificial pancreas reached the market. It's a revolution led by patients instead of big pharma or policymakers. the diabetes community penetrated the ivory towers of healthcare and left no choice to medical companies and regulators but to follow them. Diabetes patients represent the Trojan horse of digital health, and they represent the future of healthcare, because patients are the most underused resources in healthcare. Now, let me tell you about Dave DeBronkart, or e-patient Dave, as he is commonly referred to. In 2007, he was diagnosed with stage 4 kidney cancer. Fortunately, he received state-of-the-art care, and today he's alive and well. But since he got cancer-free, he has dedicated his life to spread the message of how much patients can participate in their own care. After his diagnosis, Dave, by the advice of his doctor, went online and asked around about his disease on a community site called ACOR, A-C-O-R. Within 2 hours, he got responses and valuable treatment advice that he verified with his physician, and they chose the treatment. He received crucial information that came from outside the establishment. And when he posted about his experience, he updated and furthered the knowledge of that particular community of patients. The way he puts it, back in the day, Encyclopedia Britannica and Wikipedia both were found to have similar error rates, but Wikipedia's were fixed within days. And in his case, him being engaged, being active instead of passive throughout his treatment and recovery was life-saving. Let me tell you another story. Lindsey, a software developer turned science journalist, came up with the fantastic idea of patient CVs. She's coping with multiple endocrine problems, including adrenal insufficiency and a type 1 variant diabetes with severe asthma and gastric issues. It's clear what a complex skill set it must take to manage these conditions on a daily basis. She said she came up with the idea of a patient CV when she was thinking about an upcoming appointment with a new specialist. She was trying to figure out how to present the complex and massive amount of information that she knows about her illnesses. So, she created a one-pager where she included bits and pieces about her personal and professional lives. Fallow listed all the resources and assets that help her manage her condition, her supportive partner, her health trackers, and her medical alert dog. She described what symptoms she struggles with and what her current goals are in terms of managing her illness. A CV like that is clear, concise, and could be very helpful to doctors. This idea that being a patient is no longer going to be passive adjective but an active verb is the key for the future of healthcare and, frankly, to our own well-being. Just think about it. Patients can get certain treatments, but actually managing their condition on a daily basis is their job. Their input is crucial. It's not enough to just ask patients in generic surveys and questionnaires. That's called patient centricity, and it's cute, but it's not enough anymore. We have to involve them on the highest level of decision making when creating a technology, a treatment or process for them. That's what patient design is. And it should work both ways. For example, in a Dutch hospital, an entire department was redesigned based on patient suggestions. Once patients got a seat at a table, it turned out they have very good insights of what the department was lacking. And it was these smallest things, but things that can make a difference. They asked to have more privacy, more information about their conditions and their treatments, and more games for kids in waiting rooms. They asked for better architecture with a lot of light and friendly colors, and round tables instead of the work desks to have a less confrontational and more balanced patient-doctor relationship. And the future of healthcare should be designed around that balance. We, people in healthcare, have been like, we are developing a new app for truck drivers. And when we are done, we decide to get feedback. So we reach out to athletes, bankers, and artists, but not truck drivers, because what can they bring to the table? Well, a lot. The FDA has a patient engagement advisory board already. And we encourage every organization, from the CDC to the WHO, every health insurer, pharma company, and government, to appoint a patient advisory board so they can only embrace patient design. Patients like e-patient Dave, Lindsey Fallow, or members of the We Are Not Waiting movement can contribute tremendously to healthcare, and they can actively shape policies, regulations, and the basic structures of healthcare to make it better. And we need to start listening to them now. If you like this video and would like to hear more about patient design and empowered patients, please subscribe here.